Amen. So today, we're going to share with you five different stories. Amen. All of you have a story to tell. All of us have a story to tell. But we must learn to share with others what God has done for us. Amen. God will do three things for you. God will do something in you. God will do something for you. And then God will do something through you. In you, for you, and through you. And King Nebuchadnezzar had gone through a phase in his life that he thought that because he was the king of Babylon, he was able to do everything. And if you've ever read his story, the Bible said he became proudful and God converted him in almost like an animal. And until he uplifted his eyes and he recognized that God was God, after this experience, Nebuchadnezzar expressed these words written by the prophet Daniel in Daniel chapter 4, verse 2 and 3. He says, I want all to know about the miraculous signs and wonders that the Most High God has performed for me. How great are his signs, how powerful his wonders. His kingdom will last forever, his rule through all generations. So even if your name is not Nebuchadnezzar, God has done wonders. God has performed miracles for you. God has shown his blessing over your life. God has been faithful. And like him, you and I must tell everyone what God has done for us. And then David, in Psalms 22, verse 22, David says this, I will, say with me, I will. Why does he say I will? Because no one can force you. You must learn to do it all out of your own free will. And he says, I will proclaim, I will share your names to my brothers and sisters. I will praise you among your assembled people. So that's what we want to do today. We've sought out five stories within the congregation, and they want to share with you what God has done for them. They want to share with us amongst us brothers and sisters. So now notice in your outline, write down what inspires you or what challenges you of their story, because all of them have a different story. Notice their stories are different. They have different jobs, but all of us have the same God. So if God could do it for them, say with me, God would do it for me. Amen. So at this time, let's ask Maricela is the first one. So give her a round of applause. And we're going to have Maricela Torres share her story with you this morning.
Good morning, everyone. As Pastor said, my name is Maricela Torres. And I want to share a little bit of me. I will begin by telling you where I work. I work at UTMB as a research technician. I work in biological research. Please don't call PETA. I work with infectious diseases. I also work recently in a mouse model for diabetes. So, and I will tell you why I'm telling you about my work a little bit in a little bit. I have worked for UTMB for 9 years, and I have attended New Life for 10. And I will tell you the reasons why I give my tithes. And the reason why, at the beginning when I came, I'm Mexican, as you can tell. And I wasn't Christian per se. I was another religion. Anyways, in my old religion and in my culture, the preaching or the thought of tithing is not well thought per se. And so when I first came here, Pastor Gomez started talking about it. And for me, it kind of makes sense. But I'm a science woman, so how am I going to trust God? How am I going to trust something I don't see? So I start praying about it, because once things are in my head, if they don't make logic, I will stop doing it. And if they are in my heart, when things get hard, I will stop doing it. So I need for them to be in my mind and in my heart. So I pray about it, and God gave me peace, and I start tithing. After that, I wish I could tell you, oh, buckets of money start coming. No. And honestly, hell break loose after that. But since they were in my mind and it was in my heart, I just hold on to God, and God blessed me. And I can tell you many, many stories how God has blessed me. My job is one of them. Technically, I'm not really qualified. I'm just barely working on my bachelor's degree. So God throw me on that nice job. The other one I can tell you is how God provide for me and my daughter to buy a house after I divorced and I lost pretty much a lot. But anyways, that's another story. I don't really want to tell you all those things. That is Malachi 3:10. God will provide. What I want to talk about this morning, real quick, is Malachi 3:11. How God will stop the pest from devouring your fruits. And it's in many ways, and I invite you to look how God will always protect you. Last year, especially the last month of the year and the first one of this month, my whole information got stolen. Name, social security, birthday, phone number, everything. And somebody or whoever had my information started applying for credit here and there, trying to buy houses. Not only that, they run a credit on me. They saw my good credit, praise the Lord. And they got a hold of my actual credit cards, and they request my actual credit cards to be sent to another address. And that was hell. It was really tough. I was on the phone all day, 5-6 different companies a day, and it got overwhelmed. It was just like too much for me, honestly, to handle at one point. And, you know, all day having to explain, oh, this is me, and telling your social over and over, and telling the story to everyone. It just got overwhelmed. And so anyways, but God was stronger than them and smarter than them. I don't know how. They were not able to get away with anything. Even, I mean, I tell you, they applied for a house in Buffalo, New York. They did every single story you can imagine. And every time I got a call, an email, a text, something telling me, hey, is you applying for this here and there? If not, please call us. So I did what I had to do. I called. So when I was talking to my life group about it, and my life group leader started reading Malachi 3:10, and then she went to 11, it just hit me. God will really stop the pest. Whatever, you know, it cost my time and my effort to build my good credit. And even though most of the companies will return whatever they will spend or they will take it away from my credit, it was like a really headache for me to go through all that. But God was faithful. God was stronger than them, smarter than them. And I bet right now they're still saying how I was not able to get away with this woman's credit if I had all her information. So that's my story, and one of my stories. And I just want to say, encourage everyone. If you really want to be under God's protection, just give your tithes. God is faithful. It's not a cliche. He does really take care. He does really provide for you. And for us that are single, he really fights for you.
Yes. God is faithful and God is good. Amen. So we're going to hear one more story, Berenice. So give her a round of applause and let's hear her story of God has been faithful with her.
Hi, my name is Berenice, and I've been attending here for about 16, 17 years. I work at UTMB. It's a very fun place to be, the department where I work. I have wonderful co-workers. Everything, even though it's a lot of work, it's fun. So I'm blessed to be there. And at first, I think I was about 8 when I met God the way that God really is. For the first time, we joined a church. And I think I was so drawn into knowing more and more and more about him. I started having fear of God, not in the bad way where like God was going to kill us or hurt us, but the fear of wanting to serve him, wanting to know more. I was only 8, and I think because of that, God gave me, I think I was very little, and I started having visions, and I think I even received the Holy Spirit. So I was very, very blessed. It didn't matter how young or how old I was. So ever since then, I started having that fear of wanting to do God's will. And what is it that God has done for me? He's blessed me with a wonderful family. I love my parents and my brothers and my kids. I think one of the biggest things that God has done for me is blessed me with the two boys and my parents, and Luis, right? He had to be there, and I'm still waiting for God to bless Luis a lot so that he can be rich one day and I don't have to work anymore. So that's where my faith kind of goes a little bit. But I know that by being faithful with my tithings, Pastor has mentioned it before that we have God's protection over our family. So I know I don't think a lot of you guys know, but we had a lot of problems with the kids' health, with allergies and many things that the devil wanted to bring on them. So it was a very hard, maybe 2 years. So and I just kept believing. I kept prophesying what God had said, that my kids are healthy and that God has a plan for them. So I know that God's protection is over them, regardless of what the doctors may say or what I see with my eyes. But I know that something else is out there besides what I have in front of me. So so that's why I want to continue to be faithful. That's because I want God's plans for my kids to come to life. And I think, what else? So God's protection is one of my biggest things, why I want to continue to give my tithes. I had a time in my life where me and Luis were being really blessed, and we put the tithing aside, and we noticed how things started turning not so good for us. So it was kind of late for us to come back and say, you know what? Something's not okay. Let's go back to how we were. So I recommend you guys to stay faithful. Don't wait for bad times to come to your life to realize that, you know, if you want God's protection and blessings, be faithful, and He will be faithful. So
amen. So I just noticed that the first three are for you two and B. Dang, all right. So we're going to hear Esther's story now. So give her a round of applause. And let's hear her story. Let's see what God has done for her. Amen.
My name is Esther Chavarria Perez, and some of you know me as Chachi. And I've been going here about 8 or 9 years now. I just finished my 27th year at UTMB. I'm working on my 28th year there. And recently I was promoted to a position in strategic management under President Operations. That position was a blessing. I mean, this is it. I mean, I grew up, you know, Catholic faith, and I had my relationship with God. I taught religious ed and everything. But it wasn't until I started coming here that I got closer to God. And I understood, you know, you open the Bible and it was all there. And then my dad became ill, so I would start taking over his finances. And I noticed that, he would do his tithes every week. I mean, like clockwork. And his building for the future. And so I was like, okay, you know. So then I started watching. And then I'd watch my son, David. And he was doing it. And I'm like, well, I want in on this, you know. So I started doing it. And I was like... And so I started doing it. It was hard. You know, I'm not going to be honest. We had, you know, three young kids, and it was hard to make, you know, paycheck to paycheck. But we were doing it by still giving our 10%. And then it was like, you know, I've always prayed for more, you know, and more and better for our family, especially like last year. And then for some reason, Pastor started talking the series last year about Double Door Blessings last fall. And it was crazy because this position I have now was coming open. I knew it was coming open. I knew the person was retiring. And in my heart, I wanted to go for it, but I'm a chicken, and I didn't want to do it. And but everything he was telling us was because of you know, our culture, and we always have to have that push to go through those double doors. And in my case, I really needed a push to go through that double door. And that was like on a Tuesday night. Wednesday, I went to work. I applied, And not long after that, they called me for an interview. I went on the interview, and I knew the person I was going to work for, the VP. We started about the same time at UTMB way back then. And it was a coincidence. She asked me how long I'd been there. And when I looked at the calendar, that was my 27th anniversary at UTMB. Then I went on that interview. So it was like, okay. And when I asked for the job, because I know how things work at UTMB with the hiring and stuff, I know when you take a transfer, you can't ask for more than 10%. You'd have to have some sort of leadership approval. So I bit the bullet and I asked for my 10%. I was scared, but I did it. And then when they called to offer me the job, it wasn't at the 10%. It was 1,500 more than what I'd asked for. And that was totally a blessing for me because I never gave up. I kept praying about it. And so then I didn't want to leave where I was because I was comfy, but, you know, I had to do it. So I turned in my letter and I left, and I still connect with, I still go eat lunch over there. But anyway, I go. And so it was really cool because I got this job. Well, then when Sula sends out the letters, you know, some people get them, you know, to know how much they gave the year before. I saw that letter and I looked at it and I'm like, wow, I didn't know I gave that much last year, you know, and that was more than my 10%, you know, and I know it's because I do other stuff too. And then I looked at that number and I just put it in my purse, and later that day I pulled it back out again and I checked. I said, I know that from somewhere. That was 10% of my current salary. It was like he blessed me 10% plus in this new job that I have now. And if it wasn't for you know, me being, you know, I mean, I know God provides. I know he does, and he's going to continue to provide. And he's blessed our family. I mean, we've gone through Ike. We lost everything. We got it back. You know, we've gone through illnesses. You know, we lost Dad, but I know he's still there. You know, and so that's what makes us, you know, keep going through all of these things. And so I just want all of you to know that, you know, you can't give up. You really got to keep it in your heart to do it. And I know it's hard. I know it's scary, especially with young kids. And, you know, you don't know, well, if I give them this, then I can't buy this or I can't have that. Well, you don't really need all of these things. And, you know, I learned that, you know, like, you don't need that mint chocolate chip ice cream that's in your freezer. I mean, it's like little things you can cut back on. So, I mean, I'm just here to tell you guys that was in my heart. And let me see if I make sure I got all my notes here. I tried to condense it. Let's see. Okay. Yep, that was it. So, and then...
She did it.
Now, some of you are new, and some of you have been coming here for years. The reason we share those testimonies is because what God does for each and every one of them, he wants to do it for us. This morning in the other service, in the morning service, we had an individual that I've known him. He's been here for over 30. I've been here 26. He's been here over 30 years. And I know he's been a faithful tither. But he shared that when he started coming to church, the person that handled the finances one day approached him. He says, you know what? I know you believe in God, but you don't trust God. And he goes, what do you mean I don't trust God? He goes, well, I make $400 a month, the lady said. I make $400 a month, and I give $40 of tithe, and then I have to pay my rent, and I have to pay, and I don't know how God comes through. You're making over $300 a week, and you give 1 week, and then you give another month, and then another month. You give very inconsistent. You believe in God, but you don't trust God. He says, what do you mean you don't? He says, well, trust him. Start believing God for your finances. And he says, it was an elder lady that challenged me to learn not only to believe, but to trust God for my finances. Now, I know he's been a jeweler all his life, you know. And one day he told me, Pastor, one day everything that is my dad's is going to be mine. And I said, yeah, because I know he's got like 5 or 6 more brothers. And when his dad died, his dad left the jewelry store to all his siblings. And what he did, he went to all his siblings and says, sell me your part of the inheritance and I will buy it back from you. And whatever the amount it was for the building, he went out, got a loan. He said, Pastor, you know that I lost everything after we lost everything. And next year, I will pay off the building that I should have paid off in 20 years. Next year, we will pay it off and we will be debt free. And everything that was my dad's, it's now mine. Because God will do for you what you never thought that he would do for you. and Miss Esther and Maricela and Berenice. God has been faithful, and he will be faithful with you also. Amen. So, AJ, come on, give AJ a round of applause, and let's hear his story.
Hello, good morning. For those who don't know me, I'm Anton Jackson. I don't know my name. Yeah, there it is. I go by AJ. I'm a Texas Game Warden for Texas Parks and Wildlife. I've been there for 17 years, made 17 years this month, and thank God for that. And I started attending life group, New Life Fellowship, thank you, for I think it was about 11 years. It's amazing how God was. When I first came here, I didn't know anybody. I only knew two people, Frank and Minerva. I knew them too. And I didn't know no Spanish or anything like that. And now here I am sitting up here in front of Facebook, and the whole world is seeing, telling my testimony and I like that. So, you know, God is good. He'll use you in ways that you beyond what you do. So, but I want to just share you quickly. The clock is ticking. I'm just share you quickly about that. By giving to your 10%, I didn't want to give 10% because when I first came into my employment, well, I started working. I only get paid once a month, and that's it. Nothing, no more. I don't get anything. So I remember one evening I had like 15 bills that I had to pay. And after I got through paying my salary, I mean, after I checked rent, car note, other responsibilities, I had like $500 left for the whole month to survive on. And I haven't even bought groceries yet, okay? And when I came to New Life about 6 years ago, they started a series called Live Money Hope. Okay, Live Money Hope. I still have that folder in my apartment right now. Okay, it helped me tremendously on how that I know, take the word I, this is mine's, to put in it, this is God's. Because I find out through that series that I'm just a steward of what he's done. If he can't trust me with 100, how he gonna trust me with 1,000? Okay, so I just wanted to throw that out there. God is, he really wants us to test him in his tithing. And in the book of Malachi, chapter 4:3, he says that I will make your enemies like the dust underneath your foot. And for many years, saints, I always thought the enemy was a person. An enemy doesn't have to be a person. It can be debt. It can be an illness. And so what I did was I made debt my enemy. And then once I started becoming tithed, I tithed off that 500. Then all of a sudden, I started seeing the bills going from 15 to 14 to 13 to 12. The 10. And during that live money hope, the church gave us a graph. And that graph asks you questions saying, like, okay, do you need it? And you say, no, I don't need it. Do you have something else that can suffice or what you have? Yes. Is what you want, is it broke? And you're like, no, it's not. And it says, you just saved me some money. Okay, so he taught me how to be wise into my spending. And when I started becoming wise in my spending, I started seeing that my finances start declining. It started disappearing. And now I'm debt free. Okay, because of that. Now the thing is, it wasn't like a bolt of lightning. It didn't say Shazam and it's gone. Okay. It was like 5 years, people, church, 5 long years. Okay, but I kept tithing, I kept giving. And you have to be specific on what you're praying for as well. And see, I told God, I said, it is yours. Help me get so I can be that cheerful giver that you call me to be. Okay, and that's what I want to do. So as I conclude, as building for the future, I encourage you to, the building for the future is basically, can we still come here 30 years from now? You know? When we 70 years old, you know, I'm going to be running a mile. I don't know about y'all, but when you 70 years old, can we still come to this church? I hope so. And that's where the building of the future comes up. Pastors in the church don't want that. They don't want the money. They wanted to put it, I'd like to share, they put it back into into what they're believing in. They put it back into the church. Okay. Now, you may be struggling with that 10%. My final scripture for you, if you're struggling in that area, is that the Bible says, Jesus said, I stand at the door and knock, and whoever opens up, I shall fellowship with them. Now, doors for it's like a barrier. It keeps something in and it keeps something out. Okay, as you see these two doors here, it says exit. That's title. As anything happens, you walk out that door, okay? But change that exit sign, that name to exit, to debt, tithing, 10%. He's knocking on your door, and he wants you to open up. And when I open up to him and say, you come in and take care of this, this is not mine, then I can have, then you can be saying, I can put that those dust underneath my feet. Thank you.
AJ said he's a game warden, so make sure that if you're going to go fish, you have your license. Don't say, oh, I saw you share your testimony. Yeah, but can I see your license? Every year we do a financial series, and we don't do it because we want your money. As a matter of fact, I didn't know whether he was going to share. I didn't know that it's been 6 years from that. I just, oh, live life. I forgot about that series. There's a single mom that left our church after the hurricane because she lost a lot. But a year before the hurricane, she came to me and said, Pastor, she was a single mom, three kids. She said, Pastor, I want your wife and I to pray for me because the Lord allowed me to pay off my house. And I said, how did you pay it off? He goes, well, 3 years ago, you taught us that if we honor God, he would give us to pay off sooner than we were able to. And instead of waiting another 10 or 15 years, God allowed me to pay off my house in less than 5 years. I said, where'd you get that CD? He says, you taught it. I said, man, I better buy it. Amen. So the last story is Mr. David. Mr. David is going to share his story. And come on, give him a big round of applause. Oh, by the way, he's Esther's son.
Hey, Mom. I feel like we're doing like a UTMB commercial. I also work at UTMB. It's like 4 out of the 5 people work there. But I actually just started there about a month ago, and that's actually one of the blessings here recently that I've had was doing that. And, you know, interestingly, when you apply for a position, typically you ask for a specific salary is kind of how it works. And at UTMB, they usually have like a range, you know, so I'd asked for a specific amount. And then my first day, I had like an orientation, and then my mom had texted me, and she's like, hey, you know, I don't think that's the right, she's been there so long, she has like all these like backdoor secrets to UTMB, you know, and then she's like, I don't think that's the right salary, whatever. Boy, like it turned out that what I had asked for was actually it was like 12% more than it was what I was supposed to get. And so that was, you know, one of the blessings there. But man, I have like so many stories. And I think before I share a little bit about mine, I don't have much time. But one thing that I feel like is super important for us as a church to understand is that we're here because of the sacrifices of people before us, right? And some of those people are in this room here now, but there's in the other services, I'm telling you, there's people that have like sacrificed so much, and some of them, you know, they went on to be with the Lord, and some of them, you know, they're in other places now. But you have to, like all these people have been saying, we have to trust God. We have to do that. It opens heaven for you. You know, I used to always think that, like many of us, maybe that, God just wants your money, or the church just wants your money, and it's not like that. God, he wants you to be in the channel of his grace, to be blessed by him. He wants to do it for you. He wants to bless you, and he wants to provide for you, and he wants to show you how much he can do for you. And the first, I've shared this story before. The first time I gave, I stepped out my tithes, and I was working part-time, and so I wasn't making, you know, a whole lot of money, and I was only 17. So if you're young, start giving when you're young. I was 17 when I first started tithing, and I walked out the door, and a guy, a brother of the church, he's standing there at the rail, was like, hey, and he, can you just put something in my hand? And then I checked to see what it was, and it was the exact amount that I had gave. And again, that's when I learned that God wasn't about taking my money, because he can give you whatever you need when you need it, right? And so about building for the future, I was planning in about 2007, 2008-ish, I was actually planning on leaving to go study in Australia. and studied music. If you don't know, I try to play guitar over there, and I was gonna go do that. And so thank you know, as the year went on, I transpired. It turned out that's not something that I really felt like I should do. And the tuition for that was four. And I remember this number because I saw it so many times. $4,096. That was how much the tuition was for the year to be over there. And you know, I decided not to go, but I still had that money in my account. And it just so happened, and I love that pastor and them teach about money, and it's been like AJ. I was so inspired by AJ, you know, that and all the others. And so I had, around that time, we started doing the Building for the Future series again. And so I was thinking, I was like, it probably about the week before we were going to actually do the giving, like next week. So it was like this time, like in 2008, I had said, I really felt like God's like, hey, you know, you going wasn't going to be about you. It's going to be about you coming back and helping to edify the church. So in essence, me going to Australia was going to be to help the future of the church. And so God kind of was showing me like, that money was for the future of the church. It wasn't for you, right? You know what I mean? And so I knew like this wasn't mine. This wasn't meant to be for me. And so I ended up giving that that day. And I didn't, and you know, I was like 18, I think, and I didn't really realize what I was stepping into. You know, I didn't like my mom said, you know, I didn't grow up observing how to tithe or anything like that. But man, you have no idea what God can and wants to do in your life. And it's nothing, oh man, this time thing, I'm like, oh, I have so much I want to say. So, you know, there, just because my name is David, I get to talk for a long time. now I lost my train of thought. So there's typically two types of people. There's people who are usually have a tendency to save, and typically there's people who have a tendency to spend, right? But when you become a Christian, there's a third category that comes in, and that's the servant, right? Whatever your proclivity is, it's now yet that sits under you being a servant. So we're first servants, and when I realized that, and I realized that it's in the Bible, and just trusting God. And when first time I gave, I was just doing it out of obedience, right? I was just like, I heard Pastor talk about it, even though I only stood half of it because it wasn't Spanish, you know. I saw people do it, and so I gave, and man, nothing belongs to us. Just remember that, you know. You think the 10% is God's? 100% is God's, by the way, you know. So give it. Trust God. He owns everything. He owns everything. Like. Everything, like think about everything, okay? And so just remember that, and he's a creator, he can create. You might not think that there's gonna be a way out. He's a creator, he can create ways out, he can create new ways, right? So remember these things, and remember that God is faithful, and he won't bless you just because he blessed us here, he's gonna bless you because he's just faithful to his word, and he's faithful to himself. And I hope next year, if we do these testimonies again, or even throughout this year, that I get to hear more stories from you of what God has done in your life. And test God. The Bible says test God. So test him. Put him, all right? So thank you guys for listening. Thank you, Pastor.
Come on, give all these five a big round of applause. Amen. Now, David's been a friend of my family since he was, I guess, in fifth or sixth grade. My older son has been his friend for years. So I know David from all these years, and his mom fed my child for many years, David. And when he you heard him say 4,000 what? 96? When he gave 4,096, to this day, there has not been one person that has given over that amount. There is a family that are doctors, and they gave a little bit over. I mean, they're doctors. But when he gave everything he had. Now, this is the truth. Every one of these testimonies, you can ask them. I never have ever told people what to give, and never will. The only three persons that I can forcefully do it is with my three kids. And even with that, I don't. I just taught them. So please understand that if we teach you about giving here, it's not because we want your money. We want what God has for you and what you can experience on your own. Every one of these testimonies, they experience it on their own. Now, you know, David, he said he was going to Australia. He didn't leave to Australia, thankfully, because he would have missed out marrying Cynthia. I know Cynthia didn't say amen, but I know she's. But the other part he didn't say was this. The other part he didn't say is this. His grandfather died. His grandfather died, and his grandfather gave David the inheritance of his house to him. So how is it that he gave $4,900? God has blessed him all these years, gave him a wife. You've already heard he had a job. God gave another job. And he's going to live in a house. He's not living in it yet. He's living in a house that he never purchased. He's living in a house debt-free that his grandfather gave to him. Now, I don't know about you, but I wish I had a grandfather like that. Now, do you think it was his grandfather? It was God that tugged at his grandfather to give that, because you will never outgive God when you give. So let me illustrate to you this. It's not what you give. It's if we give. All right? So you see this container here. You see this container here, this gas container. How many of you have faith that if we give, all of us give a little, we can fill it up? Let me say it again. How many of you have faith that if all of us give a little, we can fill it up? Because it's not about one person doing it all. It's all of us doing a little and all of us putting in our little contribution or whatever that we can feel and do what God has called us to do. All right? So I'm going to ask for 10 volunteers. First of all, I'm going to ask for 10 volunteers. I'm going to ask for two young people. If you're 12, 13, or 14, I'm going to ask you to help you. Two of you, 12, 13, 14, or 15. I'm going to ask you to come. 12, 13, 14, or 15. All right? If you're 12, 13, 14, come on. All right. Why is it the girls always get up first? Or the women? Amen. So this is for you. Do y'all work? That's what I thought. I knew y'all don't work. That's why I purposely did it. Because it's not about if you work. It's if you believe God. Because if you believe God, God will give you even if you don't have it. Because that's the truth. We don't give because we have. We give because God gives us to give. All right? So I've got two young girls. Now I'm going to need two men from this side, two men from this side, one from here, one from back there. Come. Now, don't run. Come on, Julius. All I'm asking is you to come. I'm not asking you to come. You don't have nothing. I'm giving you the cup. All right? I said two from back there. Two guys. Two more guys. All right, women, come on. The guys don't want to come. Ladies, I need three or four or five of you ladies. Moms, single moms, married, young. Come on. I need your help. Here you go, Miss Laura. Here you go. Here you go. Here you go. All right, is there any man in the house that can help me? Thank you. All right. Now notice this. All I'm asking you is that if you believe that we can fill it out, fill it up. That's all I'm asking you. The second thing, I ask for volunteers. I'm not asking you for nothing. I'm giving you the cup. Now, is there anything in the cup? There is something in the cup? What's in there? Huh? Air. There's air. All right, Ki-Young, come. There's air. Come on, Ki-Young. So I'm going to give you the water so you can give. It's drinking water. Yes, it's drinking water. That's right. One of the ladies said, ooh, I'm thirsty. I can drink it. Now, I purposely asked these two girls and gave them two smaller cups, and you're going to understand why. Y'all sure y'all don't work? Y'all positive? She's the one that makes the most amount of money. She's a millionaire. All right? Now, I want you to see this. I want you to see this. All of them have different amounts of water in there. Uh-oh. Now, by using our atrai, the first thing that you see is this. Their cup is smallest. They're the ones that are going to give them less. It's not the amount that God sees. God sees your gratitude. God sees if you believe him for what he's asking you to believe. All right? The other thing is this. All the adults have different amounts of water. All of them have different amounts. Because as you heard, all of us work at different jobs. All of us make different money. It's not what we make. It's not what we give. It's our faith and our obedience to God that we believe that God can do it. All right? Now, you can do three things with that water. He said, is it drinking water? Of course it's drinking. Yeah, he's just asking. That's right. I'm glad you asked. Because you can do three things with the water. You can drink it. You can spill it. Or you can give it. Now, for this illustration, honestly, because you're on the stage, you're not going to drink it. But in secret, that's what we do. God gives us to give, but because we think it's ours, like AJ says, it's not ours, like David says, we use it, and then at the end of our lives, we don't have anything to show, because everything that God gave us, not only was us to enjoy it, but to give. There are certain things that God gives you to give. Now, at New Life, we will never force you to give. It is your obedience and your gratitude that we will challenge you, we will inspire you, but we will never force you. Because the Bible says that God loves the cheerful giver. So this morning, did y'all think this morning that y'all were going to be on this platform? Of course. I like her. I like her enthusiasm, her positive, of course. Did you think you were going to be part of illustration? No. None of you thought. Well, that's what God wants to do. God wants to surprise you with things that you never thought that you would be part of. So, will y'all help me fill in this jar? So, ladies, y'all be the first, since y'all were the first one daring that came up. All right? So, notice, theirs was the smallest. Because it's not the amount. One day Jesus was picking up an offering, and the Bible says that all the rich people gave of what they had. But there is a lady that came and gave everything that she had. That day, she wasn't one that gave the most. Because God never sees the amount. God always sees your heart, how you give it. So the rest of you can help me. As you're pulling out, you can go to your seat. Come on, y'all can help me. Pour it in there. Notice that all of us give, we can fill up and we can do what God has called us to do. Whatever God gives you, you share it and you give it. Notice. Come on, give them a round of applause for helping me. All right? Now, what I want to conclude with is this. Tonight, there will be a single mom. There will be a single mom that will share her testimony. And this is her testimony. She says that a year ago, I made this challenge. And the first thing that she thought was, oh, pastor wants to go on my vacation, on his vacation with my money. That's the first thing that came to her mind. Here he goes. Pastor wants to go on his vacation with my money. And one day he says, what money? I haven't even given. But God challenged her. And tonight, if you want to hear her testimony, you can come. God has surprised her. because God has opened doors that she never thought that God could open, and God has provided over and over and over. And now she says, I realize it wasn't for you. It was for my vacation. It was for my future. It was for the blessing for my family. All right? So what I want you to do is they gave you the outline, and then they gave you this 3-month challenge. Some of you that already give, I'm going to ask you to fill it out. All I want you to do is put your name. All I want you to put your name and just write there somewhere where your signature is. Just write down, Pastor, I'm going to continue to honor God. I'm going to continue to give, because we don't have to challenge you no more. You already do it. But the rest of you, I want to challenge you for you to prove God, for you to test God. Now, this is a challenge. This is what we call the 3-month challenge. This is where you're going to challenge God, or you're going to test God, because the Bible says, test me, God says, if I won't open the windows of heaven. And this is what you're going to do. You're going to get an envelope starting today, starting next week. Whenever you decide, you're going to give it online. Don't give it cash. Don't give it cash, because in cash, we won't be able to get, return to you the money if you want your money back. But this is a challenge. In 3 months, God does not show you that he is faithful, we will return back to you, no questions asked, the amount that you gave. If you gave $10, if you gave $1,000, if you gave $10,000, in 3 months, whatever you give, this is a challenge, and God did not show his faithfulness to you, no questions asked, our accountant will make out a check. At least we saved your money for 3 months and you didn't spend it. All right? You didn't spend what you were going to spend the next three months. All right? So that's what we're asking you. You take this 3-month challenge and see God come be faithful to you. All right? So all you got to do is write today's name, date, write your name, write your address, zip code, your phone number. We will send this back to you and say, hey, you took the challenge. And for the next 3 months, every week or every month, AJ said that he should get paid every month. If you get paid weekly, if you get paid, the first 10%. You give to God, and you're going to see God. Like David said, we pray that next year, you're the one that's sharing your story. You're the one that's sharing your testimony, because God is faithful. Amen. So if you want to take the challenge, you fill it out. If you're going to continue to give, you just write your name, and we'll know that you're the ones that give, and we're going to thank God for you. Okay, now listen. David said, God, what you give us, we give back to you. God will never ask from you something that he first does not give to you. God will always give it. Now listen to this. And when he gives it and he asks for you, he simply wants, because he wants to give you more health, more life. Not necessarily God's going to give you more money. God is going to give you many other things. I haven't been sick. My air conditioning, I changed it last year. I should have changed it 3 years ago, but it lasted me 3 more years. In 3 years, I saved the money. So I knew this year I was going to have to change my AC, because I don't like to be in my house and it looks like I'm doing exercise all sweaty. I want to be cool. So God gave me the money, what I should have paid 3 years ago. In 3 years, I saved it. So last year, at the end of the year, December, I changed it before the summer comes in. I'm ready. Cool air in my house. All right? So are you ready to give to God? All right? So that's all I'm asking you. You give your part, and you help us do what God is doing in your life, and you'll see God bless you. So I'm going to ask you to stand. You're not giving money. All you're doing is, all you're going to do is give this paper where you're going to take the 3-month challenge. Now listen, no hard feelings. If you don't want to take the challenge, we're never going to. You didn't do it. You didn't. That's up to you. This is between you and God. But if you take it, you will see God's faithfulness. And again, and in 3 months, God doesn't do something, I don't know what God is going to do for you, but if God doesn't show his faithfulness, no questions asked, you write an email, you call the office, says to what? March, April, May, June. By the end of June, we'll give you your money back. Amen. So if you're going to do it, raise your paper and say, God, thank you, thank you, thank you, because you're going to show me that you're God. You've shown me that you're God. And now, God, I accept this challenge to trust you with my finances, to trust you with my future, bless my children, bless my future, continue to bless our church. And this morning we worship you.